puzzle answers.
And second, this is fancy.
If you don't know the answers or you didn't have time to complete it, take it home with you. Take it back to that dorm room and see if you can even figure out, like, rock, how hall, houses, Madonna del Mistrato, what? The name of the coffee shop located in Leahy Hall is called what? Tell me, everyone. And I'm so excited because now they are going to stay open till 7:30 p.m. for our, especially for our graduate students' nighttime classes. So make sure you visit it. And it's just good to talk to one another. Invite, come get me out of my office and say, come on, Dean Pellegrino, let's have a cup of coffee. So now, would all of our wonderful graduate students raise their hand, and the ones assisting our graduate students, how many colleges have graduate students and upperclassmen who said, I want to come to this too tonight? Would you give, freshmen, would you give them a round of applause? So I'm going to ask now, would the graduate students start the icebreaker? Majors, would all the OT majors raise their hand? Woo-hoo! We have a lot of nursing majors. Would the nursing majors raise their hand? How about teacher education? Woo! How about health administration, human resources? Wow! Exercise science, future DPTs perhaps? Wow! And did I miss anybody? Counseling! Whoa! Look at that. All right, so we are all set because here's my question. What is the name of the PCPS four-year professional program? If you don't remember, well, you get a lot of emails. Zero credits, right? It's on your t-shirt. What is it called? Tapestry. And it's the start of our journeys because we are the professional college. And with that comes a lot of responsibility, especially being men and women for and with others. And you'll hear all about criminal background checks, watch, don't get DUIs, all of these things, because this is part of who we are. Are we fit for the profession? So with that, I bring my wonderful assistant dean, Mr. Ray Schwenk, to briefly talk about Tapestry and CDM. Well, let's hear it for him.
Okay, I'm going to keep this brief because you're probably sick of getting emails from me already. They will decrease as the semester goes on, but there are a lot of activities up front. So what we're going to talk about tonight is community-based learning. I referenced it briefly during our welcome weekend. It's a requirement throughout your 4 years, and it's so important that you need it to graduate. It's actually listed on your transcript, and so we kind of track that throughout the 4 years. So you got an email from me the other day kind of laying out some of the requirements. The first thing you need to do, there are always three parts of community-based learning. First thing you need to do is complete your community-based learning contract. Okay, and for every community-based learning activity you're gonna do, you're gonna fill one of these out. We're gonna talk about what that looks like for the Blessing of the Books project, which everyone is doing through Tapestry. But you need to do this for every course you have that has a community-based learning component. So the three components are contract, activity, timesheet. And now I know I sent an email to you saying that the contract is due yesterday. I understand we didn't get a chance to talk about this, so we can extend that deadline until Monday. I looked today, there were about 118 people that did it, so we still have about another 170. I'm gonna briefly go over that process because I linked to the D2L site that has step-by-step instructions. So I'm gonna go through those very briefly. You log into MyScranton, go to self-service, and the Student Services and Financial Aid tab at the top. There's a link that says Community-Based Learning Contract. You're gonna click that twice, and then you need to select a term. A term is just what this semester is, so it's fall 2017. And then this is the Community-Based Learning Contract. And again, for every course that you have that has Community-Based Learning, you're gonna fill one of these out. So what I linked to on D2L is the instructions to do it for our Blessing of the Books project. So for there, you're gonna skip down to 1B, you're gonna put the agency name, which is the PCPS Dean's Office, our location, Leahy Hall. You can list me as the contact person and my phone number. I have all that information listed on the D2L site. Then you come down here and there's a pull down tab, and this is important because when I'm checking to see if you've completed your contract, we need to make sure you selected the correct course. So the course that you want to select is our Tapestry course, which is PCPS 101. And then the instructor, you can put Dean Pellegrino. And then lastly, the third part of any contract is what the service is, what the community-based learning is that you're going to do. So in this case, we're just going to put in the Blessing of the Books project. When you've done all that, you click Submit Application. And again, I know I'm going a little quickly. If you go to the D2L site, again, there are step-by-step instructions. Okay, so that's the first part. That's the contract covered. Then you'll do the actual community-based learning or service. In this case, what this is for Blessing of the Books, there's a couple parts to it. One, after the lecture tonight, you're going to have to write an essay that's due October 4th, okay? And that's submitted physically to the dean's office. You don't upload it through D2L. You're going to print it out. You're going to physically walk it to the dean's office, second floor, Leahy Hall, and deliver that. And that's due October 4th, okay? So that's sort of one part of what you're getting community-based learning hours for. The second part is the actual Blessing of the Books project. And for those of you who have already had your freshman check-in meetings, you might have seen there was a big board there where we asked you to indicate there are a series of days and times when you can come to write little messages in the book and also bring a book. So those are the two parts. Bring a new book and write messages for a half hour. You're going to want to sign up for those after your freshman check-in meeting. If you haven't had it yet, then be sure to do that going forward. Okay, so we have the contract, the activity, which is Blessing of the Books, bring a book, write an inscription on the date and time you signed up for. And then lastly, there's the timesheet. Okay? So if you look in your folders, you'll see there's already a timesheet that's mostly filled out for you. Okay, it has attend required lecture and write essay by October 4th, 2017. And then you get 5 service hours for that. And then also, when you come to your session where you're going to bring a book and write some messages and books, that's where you get the other hours. And that's when you want to bring your timesheet. So after you have signed up for your session, you've come, you've brought the book, you've written the messages, we will collect this timesheet and sign off for you. We'll mark it in Tapestry that you've completed it, and then you'll get credit for those hours that you've done for CBL as part of Tapestry. And again, remember this contract activity timesheet, you have to do that for each course that is community-based learning. I know that was a lot, I want to keep it brief. You will hear from me a few more times throughout the semester, but I promise it will die down a little bit. If you have any questions, come to the dean's office, email me, call me. I'm more than happy to help you out with the contract or any questions you might have about community-based learning. And with that,
so take time later this evening and go through your purple folder. First of all, my favorite poem is in here, Falling in Love, by Father Pedro Arrupe. And there's a note that talks about Tapestry. A lot of important dates. First of all, was the PCPS part of Tapestry is the freshman check-in. So I would like our wonderful PCPS advisors to please stand, and you should know all of them because they're here to ask to answer any questions at any time. Bernie Krizan, Diana Howe, Tammy Manka, and over it all is our associate dean, Dr. Vicky Castellanos. And remember, PCPS freshman check-in, we can't wait to see it. And we're almost finishing it up. We've got one more week. And so if you haven't been there yet, you'll soon be there. The big thing that's also happening is September 14th is the Royal Meetings, and that's with Father James, what's his last name? Martin, correct? And then don't forget about those purple tubs. You'll see the freshman seminar class, the living learning community of the helping professions. They're doing something big with these purple tubs, and they're collecting lots of children's books for us. So the dates are all here, a calendar is here, the essay, everything about what's happening for PCPS. But what's really happening is tonight, we are really, really lucky. Not only do we have one of our faculty members from Counseling and Human Services who actually teaches the first year seminar, but he's also the executive director of the Jesuit Center, and he also finished his dissertation from Georgetown on one of my favorite topics. But tonight he's going to talk about the Ignatian spirit in the helping professions, embracing the call to care, and that's what PCPS is about. Please, a warm PCPS welcome for Father Patrick Rogers.
Thanks, everybody. I'm really excited to be here again. I'm Father Patrick Rogers. I'm originally from the great state of Maryland. Anybody else from Maryland here? No one's from Maryland. Jesus have mercy. Two people. We know we have the best flag of all the flags. So anyway, we're not going to go there. But anyway, it's really good to be here. I'm excited. And I'm excited to be teaching as well, because I just love this school and this college. You all do such fantastic work. So the title of my talk is called The Ignatian Spirit in the Helping Professions, Embracing the Call to Care. So in typical Jesuit fashion, what I'm going to do is I'm going to outline just a brief history of the Catholic nature of the helping professions and where the Western world basically gets its sense of duty from this. And then I'm going to talk about the Ignatian character and then specifically about what we do here at the University of Scranton. Okay? So, the whole Ignatian spirit, the whole way we talk about caring in the Western world, and frankly here at the University of Scranton, is deeply rooted in the Christian tradition. And so what's important about that is what you see behind me, or on your screens, I guess, is a picture of Jesus healing people. And so there's stories over stories in the Gospels, and in the Acts of the Apostles, of Jesus and the Apostles touching people and healing them. So that's important. The idea of touching, of being there, being present to people, asking them what they need, and giving them something based on their human dignity. So that's just one part of the component. The Acts of the Apostles, and in Christian tradition also, there are many saints and people who had the power of healing. The picture you see here is a painting done of an act that happened in the mid-19th century at Lourdes in France. The young lady there is Bernadette, and she had an apparition of the Virgin Mary that came to her. But what's important in at least the Catholic world and to many people is the fact that at Lourdes, hundreds of thousands of people go to Lourdes every year to seek healing, because there's a spring there. And people immerse themselves into the spring. And actually, many people do find real healing, miraculous healings, from ails. It could be anything from arthritis to depression, sometimes cancer, things of that nature. It's an amazing place. Many young people actually go there on a pilgrimage, and they actually assist the people into the different pools. Literally, that's a ministry. So basically, you get into a bathing suit and you're lifting these people who are incapacitated into these pools and praying over them and praying with them. It's, again, a very powerful ministry, but it's a big part of the Christian tradition. Okay? St. James said, call the priest, let the priest anoint them for the forgiveness of sins and for healing of mind and body. So from the earliest days of the church, the example of Jesus' life, of the apostles, they came to this conclusion that every single life had dignity. And so that's a key word you're going to have to know. You're going to have to write that down, or that's going to be a part of your paper, I hope, at least on the fourth. Because human dignity is the core value of the helping professions. And there's reasons for that. And we'll talk about that right now. So you know, I presume most of you know, that the Catholic Church says abortion is not a viable option for a fetus. Many people don't know that capital punishment, again, is something that the Catholic bishops have roundly criticized and critiqued in American life. Most people don't know that. And the reason is because in the philosophical tradition of the Catholic Church and of the way that we see dignity, again, based on what we know from Christ and the early apostles and the way they treated people, that every human life is worthy, even if somebody has done something really bad, that we should not be taking that life. And so it's a consistent ethic across the line, or across this spectrum, I guess you would say, that all life is important. So it's not just life like abortion or the death penalty. It's also, are we giving people fair wages? So there are many encyclicals and documents of the church that say we should be treating people fairly. budgets, national budgets in any country should reflect ways in which education is being taken care of specifically for people who are in need. How are governments or how are communities treating poor people? Bishop Ben Barrett, who is our bishop here in Scranton, is very active in those in that way, talking to people about, you know, paying fair wages and making sure that people are treated fairly, because it's a consistent ethic of life and of care for every aspect of a person, okay? So, let's see what the next one is. Corporal works of mercy. Some of you may have gotten this in your Catholic high schools. Not all of you, of course, went to Catholic high schools, and some of you didn't get it even if you were in Catholic high schools. But this is important. Way that, the Catholic imagination works on the helping professions and our duties as Christians. So the corporal works of mercy are found in the teachings of Jesus and give us a model for how we should treat all others as if they were Christ in disguise. It's very important. They, quote, are charitable actions by which we help our neighbors in their bodily needs. They respond to the basic needs of humanity as we journey together through this life. Okay, so they are. And again, this is an ancient tradition of the church. This is something that people just came up with 20 years ago or something. This is from the first centuries of Christianity. How are we to treat each other? Feed the hungry. Give drink to the thirsty. Shelter the homeless. Visit the sick. Visit the prisoners. Bury the dead, which is an interesting thing I'm going to come back to. And then give alms to the poor. Now, for us in the helping professions, well, in a Christian ethical world, all of these things are important, of course. But for us specifically, who are in the helping professions, I'm going to talk about the idea of visiting the sick, burying the dead, and visiting prisoners has a little bit of overlap with that as well. Again, but this is all about human dignity. How do we treat our neighbors, and how do we take care of them in their bodily needs? So in some ways, you can kind of put aside some of the spiritual stuff that many priests and many of us talk about, which of course is an important component of the human condition, but for now we're talking about bodily needs, okay? So we have the corporal works of mercy. So visiting the sick, visiting prisoners, and burying the dead. If you notice this, all of these things are again, physical things that require you to actually have an encounter with somebody or do something. So in the Catholic imagination, the way that we do help in the helping professions is not abstract. It is never abstract. It's always going to have a real application. So again, feeding the sick is obviously feeding or visiting a prisoner. That's a sacramental notion of how we Catholics understand the world, and basically the one of the ethos that basically animates our own university, because it's a Catholic university. So let me explain. So sacramentality. In the Catholic Church, there are seven sacraments. Some of you know this, some of you don't. But every one of the sacraments requires basically two people interacting in a very real way, in a very real space. So for instance, if I'm a priest and I'm baptizing a child, this may sound silly, but I cannot baptize a child unless I'm there with the child or baptize a person. You can't marry a couple via Skype. I've had many people try to call me and want to confess to me over the phone. Most of the time it's just my nephews who've had too many beers, but anyway. It's like, no, I can't hear your confession right now because we're on the phone. Oh, but you can still say the words. It doesn't make any difference. I have to be present to do it because it's a sacramental thing. And if you're going to do something that's sacramental and holy, you have to be present to people. Anointing someone. You can't anoint someone by distance. You anoint them because they're there and you are there. And so that's what's really important. So again, human dignity is the first thing that I really want to stress, this idea that every single person is worthy of care, bodily care. And that's because of the way the church sees its mission. Again, through the corporal works of mercy, how how we're supposed to respond to people. And why is that? Because we have a sacramental nature, a sacramental understanding of how we are supposed to engage the world. That it's supposed to be hands-on, doing it, and it's not abstract. Again, we do abstract things in the salons of academia, and we are a part of that. But with this, this is all real stuff. And you're, of course, involved in that because you're all in the helping professions. Okay. Let me see, turn over here. All right, let's see what we got here. These two photographs come to us from a Jesuit prep school in Cleveland, Ohio, St. Ignatius College Preparatory School. There was a man there named Jim Skerrill, who was a lay person, taught there for years, and he had this idea, this great intuition, that it was really sad that many homeless people are died and put in basically potter's fields without ever having anyone witness their funeral. And so he started this ministry with the boys at this school, where they actually would go to the funeral and act as pallbearers to these poor people that had nothing else, no one else to mourn them. And if you remember, if we go back, see the one second from the bottom, bury the dead. That's an early corporal work of mercy. Now, when you think about that, that's a little bit strange for us because we're so sanitized away from like death. But even 50 or 60 years ago, if someone died in your home, or if someone in your family died, you waked them in your home. You had them in a casket in your parlor. And people would come, and they would say, "I'm so sorry." They would say some prayers, and then a day later, because they didn't have all the embalming and stuff like that, they would put the body in the ground. But again, a corporal work of mercy, we're burying the dead. The dignity of a person is beyond compare. So even if that person were a murderer or something, a terrible thing, they still deserve, and because of their inherent, the incarnation, because of their inherent worth, their dignity of burial. And so it's very moving. And so now, I know Scranton Prep right here, our prep school here at Scranton does it as well. And there are many other Jesuit schools doing this, and I'm sure there are other schools that have done it as well. I think it's an amazing ministry. Hundreds of kids sign up to do this every day. And it's powerful stuff when you ask them what it feels like to go to mourn someone who they don't know, yet heart calls to heart, dignity to dignity, the human flesh to human flesh. We are all one body. It's powerful stuff, okay? So I'm giving you an idea of the sacramentality nature of the Catholic imagination. Where does that come from? This is a picture of the birth of Christ, of course. Again, in a Catholic imagination, we say that if God deigned to become a human being, that even in our sinfulness, even in our craziness that happens in human life and human endeavors, human flesh is again worthy of dignity, worthy of help, worthy of care, deep and abiding care. Again, that's where you all fit in. You are the caretakers of the future. You're doing it now. You're going to be doing it in a more explicit way later on. But based on the fact that if God really became a human being, that we have to take that seriously. We can't ignore flesh. It may sound silly, but that's a Catholic way of imagining the world. Okay? Here's a picture of Pope Francis. Pope Francis would go to prisons. He still does. He goes to prisons in Rome. He goes to homeless shelters in Rome. Wherever he is, he's in Colombia right now. I guarantee you he will have a meal with homeless people or will go to a prison. His first Easter, or Good Friday as Pope, which is the day that Jesus was crucified, for those of you who aren't Christian, Pope Francis went to a prison and he washed the feet of the prisoners. And what's he doing there? He's kissing their feet. He's honoring their flesh. He does not know what these prisoners did. They did not tell him. He did not ask. But it doesn't make any difference because they're human beings. They're worthy of dignity. It's very powerful stuff. So now, let's talk a little bit about St. Ignatius and what he brings to bear specifically about his interpretation and how we interpret it in an Ignatian lens, this idea of caring for people. So Ignatius of Loyola, one of his famous sayings is, love manifests itself more in deeds than in words. I'm sure your parents probably said that to you at different times and in different ways. It's a good statement. I'm tired of hearing you yapping about something. What are you doing about it, right? Yeah, I'm going to clean my room. I'm going to do that. Sure. Get off your butt and do it. Let's say Ignatius basically saying that in the 16th century. If you really love, you're going to manifest it in what you do and how you act in the world. The care that you give your fellow human beings. So anyway, that's a very particular thing for St. Ignatius. Now, this picture of St. Aloysius Gonzaga is of him, a young saint. He was 23 years old when he died, and he's caring for a plague victim. Aloysius was a young Jesuit. At the age of 23, he was in Rome caring for victims of the plague that had wracked that place. Again, this is 16th century, so those kind of things happened all the time. And Aloysius was so devoted to people, even when nurses and doctors, everybody else fled, that he ended up contracting the plague himself and dying. He is the patron saint of young people, and he was, I guess, made that back in the 19th century. Gonzaga University, the basketball team that was in the basketball championship last year, is named after him, St. Aloysius Gonzaga. To my deep horror, when they interviewed some of the players on the team last year, they're like, so what do you know about Aloysius Gonzaga? And they're like, I don't know, I just play basketball. I'm like, are you kidding me? You pass a statue of this guy every day. You didn't even bother to figure out who he was. St. Aloysius Gonzaga, very famous saint, very beloved. In the Jesuit tradition, again, the Jesuits were formed in 1540. From the earliest times on, Jesuits have to do work in hospitals. St. Ignatius, the founder of the Jesuits, made it clear that every single Jesuit has to work in hospitals. I had to work in hospitals when my first year in the Jesuits. I worked in an AIDS hospice in New York City, and this was in 1992, when people were still dying of AIDS all the time. And I had to deal with and comfort people who were dying that I didn't necessarily know, but you come to know after a while. And why does Ignatius want every Jesuit to do that? Because he wants to rend open your heart so that you can't abstract this person's suffering. No, that person is right in front of you. And AIDS, the way that AIDS work, it affects everybody differently. So there might be a guy who looks perfectly normal one day, and the next day he's blind. And you walk in, and all of a sudden this guy's blind. He's 28, 29 years old. He looks as healthy as you or I, and he's blind. Or another person just racked with tumors all over his body, whatever it may be. And you have to care for that person in their individuality and not flee, and it's tough. We have to learn how to do that. Jesuits were famous in the late 16th century for, again, sometimes we were the only ones taking care of plague victims. And hundreds, if not thousands, of Jesuits died doing that ministry. There was a famous scene in Naples, I believe, where everyone fled except for the plague victims. And Jesuits swarmed out over the city, and every Jesuit was giving a particular street to take care of. So they were responsible for the plague victims on the street. Every Jesuit had to work in hospitals. Again, sacramentality, taking care of flesh, the dignity of human people cannot be denied, and that's a part of our ministry and his story. Every Jesuit has done that. Father Cole has done that. Any Jesuit you ever meet has done that. If they lie to you about it, or if they say they didn't do it, that means they're not a Jesuit, they're lying, and they just want to be awesome, and they're not. Okay? I'm going to make sure I'm not forgetting anything. All right. So, the name of my talk, part of it was Embracing the Call to Care. I hope that you all noticed that outside of your Levy Center, that there are those flags that kind of are on the flagpole, and it does say that. You know? Have any of you noticed that? It says, Embracing the Call to Care. There's the arms. Have you all noticed that? I should have taken a picture, and I didn't. But they're right outside. If you could go right here. They're flagpoles, and that's where they are. So that's your motto. I guess it's your motto. embracing the call to care. So I want to talk about call, and I want to talk about vocation. This is another thing that's going to be hopefully a part of your papers, okay? Because I was intrigued by this, embracing the call to care. In the Catholic imagination, which this university is a part of, to have a call is to recognize some spiritual dimension in the work there. Something that's happening to us and amongst us. That you have been called to this place at this time for a particular reason. Because God wants to give you many good gifts. Again, that's the Catholic imagination, it's the Catholic tradition. You don't have to believe that. Some of you might say, listen, that's just sign on not a lot. I don't care about any of that stuff. But in the Catholic imagination, that's the way we would look at it. And again, to say that there's a call to care is different than saying I have a job. Okay, so a call to care means that there is a vocation. And that's really important. So let's talk just a little bit about vocation, and then I'll finish it up. So a vocation, a definition of vocation would be, well, actually, basically called a care of vocation like no other. I like this one on the left. It says, to put a patient on a bedpan, you lift them up by the buttocks, not the way you did it. So I think that's kind of funny. And then, of course, we have a physical therapist over here, so there are many different ways that we care for people. Okay? Sometimes the ways we care for people are ways that are not necessarily pleasant. Cleaning bedpans is probably not a very pleasant way to care for people, but if somebody needs it, that's a thing that we need to do. All right, a vocation is where your greatest passion meets the world's need. Again, that's going to be something I hope that's in your paper. Where is your passion and where is the world need? Again, in the Catholic imagination, we don't talk about jobs, we talk about vocation. Because if you have a vocation to something, that means that you're going to stick it out through good times or when bad. I'm a priest. I have a vocation to the priesthood. My priesthood is not a job. I don't leave my priesthood when I leave the University of Scranton or leave the church or whatever. I'm a priest. You are caregivers. That's what we do. That's how we do it. So that's an important way of understanding. We are called to give care personalis, care for the whole person in their individual circumstances. Again, you don't care for an old person like you would care for a young person. You care for each person in their need, which means that you have to pay attention and actually be ready to receive them. Receive the person you're in front of, okay? And finally, I love this quote. This same guy, Jim Scarrell, that I talked about before, started that ministry with the dying. Jesuit education doesn't make you better than everybody else. It makes you better for everybody else. We do education in a very deliberate way. Again, we don't guess at outcomes. We don't hope for better things. We work to better things. We work towards building up ourselves so that we can actually respond to things correctly. We work on building up our communities and our families. We don't guess at it, and we don't pretend. In the Catholic imagination, again, incarnation, dignity, care for the person, cur personalis, showing yourself, love manifesting itself in deeds rather than words are the most important things that you can do as caregivers. I thank you for your time, and I'm going to say bless you all, because you guys are terrific. If you need anything, I'm around, all right? Cheers.
Check their folders.
I'm up for a class. Okay, ready? Here we go. We're gonna choose this one right here. So what do we got?
All right, so if your number is 072897, would you come on up, please?
Come on.
072897. Focus questions. Thank you. And then Dr. Leanne Eschbach will be up.